Welcome back to Talk Gnosis. We've got artist, spiritual coach, a whole bunch of other things that we're going to talk about. Alex Coma, welcome back to the show. Hi, Alex.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me again.
Our last interview was specifically about your art, but I do want to kind of catch up with you about your art. It has been a couple of years since we interviewed you. I want to see where you're at with your practice. I want to hear your latest thoughts, realms, channeling to the other side in regards to art. And then we'll get into some of your coaching, and which is a relatively new project. But Alex, for people who don't know about you yet, can you tell us a bit about yourself, a bit about your artistic and spiritual practice?
So I started my artistic career, I guess, in 2017 was kind of the beginning of my first solo show, transitioning from photography to painting. So it was my first like painting show, and slowly moving away from photography into the realm of the, I guess, metaphysical, in the sense that my own inner life became the vehicle to create imagery. So instead of relying on a tool, which is the camera, which is connected to reality as we see it through the scientific lens, I wanted to be able to channel whatever is within me to create these symbolic and metaphysical landscapes, symbolic with architecture representing the body. And ever since then, my art just became a tool for me to go deeper into the abstract spiritual concepts that are often like very hard to understand until witnessed from like firsthand from within. And so for me, doing these paintings opens up some space inside me. So of course, at the beginning, it was not always like that. At first, it was more unconscious, and it was more like different types of mirrors I would put up. The paintings would become mirrors for me to see different aspects of myself. And then later on, like in the past few years, now it's more integrated into like, it is a tool for like opening up almost a portal, consciously opening up a portal that's specific to something I'm researching or want to learn about. So it has shifted, but it is more than ever like integrated. My art is my inner self in many ways.
Yeah, that's really fascinating. And it's awesome to hear about your journey. And I find it very interesting artistic practice. Sometimes you see these shifts, you go deeper, but when you look back, you see that there is a path that you didn't even realize you're on. Have you experienced that when you look back at your earlier work, where you see sort of repeating themes, deeper meanings, stuff that you weren't really aware of before?
Yeah, like my first series that I was describing in 2017 was like basically setting the trends of my life. So it was like seven paintings, and they were each kind of my own hero's journey. So like they set the tone for the years to come, what I was going to go into, and like the mystical concepts I would be exploring that as part of my own personal mythology, the themes that kind of link together. I think it's, yeah, like it brought me from a place of unconscious suffering. And I say that because it was like emotionally repressed emotions, to a place of seeing and acknowledging those emotions, and then opening them up to go live them, and bringing me to a place where I was kind of stuck in my ego because of these traumas that were kind of making me close down, opening me up slowly to now see my grander purpose, which is being of service somehow to humanity, and allowing me to, so art was, it was actually bringing me towards acknowledging the bigger truth of my life and putting it in practice with confidence. And so it was like, I do feel like it has been the most transformative tool I've had in my life, accompanied, like, of course, with introspection, meditation, like different techniques, more occult techniques also to open up these channels. But there was I would definitely say that it was meant to be this way. Like, it doesn't feel like it's just a coincidence that all of this was part of my path.
And we are going to link up your previous show with us where we actually looked at some of your art together and obviously linked to your websites, because we talked about this last time as well, but I think when people sometimes hear occult art, esoteric art, they have really cheesy images in their mind because there's a lot of cheese out there. But, you know, your work is subtle without being overly mysterious. It's deep without it being a puzzle that you're supposed to sit down and figure out. You know what I mean? There's a symbolic language that flows, but it's not like, oh, you know, I'm supposed to figure out A, B, C, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we talked about what your art has been doing for you, but with the spiritual ideas in your art, do you intend your art to be used by others for spiritual and contemplative reasons to inspire change in those who view and buy them? Or is it strictly, you know, are these themes coming up for your own use and then appealing to people on maybe some level they don't realize? How do you sort of feel about your art in relation to those who are buying it, who are viewing it, who are engaging with it?
Mm-hmm. Well, definitely when I started my career, and I think it's the case for lots of artists, it feels like you're creating art for healing purposes. And most people don't recognize that, but you are addressing your deepest emotional, the emotions that are the most active inside of you is what wants to be expressed. So that's why you see some artists like that go into something very dark or something very bright, or I have observed the tendencies of certain artists within their art, and the challenge here is not to get stuck into this, like to actually acknowledge it so you can evolve as an artist. But this being said, I feel like at first my art was attractive mostly like to people that were living something similar that I was living when I did create the art, and therefore would be more of a unconscious, more like of a, yeah, there was less intention behind it. And now that I'm the past 2 years, I've been traveling a lot, but it has moved a lot within me. And I feel like my new works, especially the one I'm doing now, it feels like it's more non-personal than any work I've done. In this sense, it feels like this artwork is a portal that I'm channeling more than a piece of art that describes my personality, you know? So in this sense, there are, and my last show as well was all the art pieces were meant as contemplative pieces. So like I portrayed the archetype of water using symbols like the color, so very blue, very emotional, dark, and like kind of this introspective emotional realm that I created. Then there was fire, which was like a volcano erupting, and background is all red, and there's a sigil of the archangel Michael, which is the archangel of fire, and so it was very packed with these symbolism. And these, I think, they could be used as contemplative tools to connect with these archetypes that exist within all of us. And the most recent one I'm doing right now, which is like a huge painting 4 feet by 6 feet, it is very like the way I create art has shifted as well. As before, I was like more trying to program and seeing with my own imagery that I have to construct an image and then creating a meaning and a story. But now, like as I'm creating it, like some synchronicities happen that are like, so for example, I was planning to do this big painting for a few months now, like at least 5 months. And the center, well, the main piece that is now just the center of the piece was supposed to be the whole painting. But I felt something was missing. It was like a vertical landscape and the imagery is very rich. There's a lot of details. There's a lot of things going on. But I felt something was missing. And then we were house sitting and then we're in someone's bedroom because that's where we were staying. So it's not my own place. And then one night there's just this painting that falls off the wall. And then I look it up And it was an imagery of the goddess, Egyptian goddess Nut, which is the feminine goddess of space, of ether, the divine creative feminine energy. And I saw the image and I was like, okay, I get it. Like, it was an instant download. I was like, okay, I need to put an arch around the painting. The piece I was supposed to be, the whole thing should just be in the center, and there should be an Egyptian arch with the goddess Nut around it. That is kind of like creating a portal into this realm of the divine feminine. And like recently, like this week, a few days ago, we're in another house sitting now, and I was seeing the outside. So there is like an open shower with like a kind of frosted curtain. But from where I was in the shower, I could see through the curtain outside. And for the past week, I've been very fascinated with the Ankh to understand its meaning, because it has been resonating for me to do something with it. I don't know what, maybe a sculpture to go with the show that I'm creating. But ends out through this frosted curtain, I saw the highlights of the tree. So where the tree was whiter, it creates a shape. And I saw an Ankh in like the silhouette of the tree. But it's like an Ankh that has it's like this, the symbol of the Ankh, but with some specificities, as if like it's the same symbol, but like another version of it. Which I'm trying to still decipher what it's meaning, but it will be now part of the painting. It'll be, so there's like stuff like that that I'm gonna put. I know it's supposed to be there. I just don't know what it means yet.
Precisely. Can you tell us how you discovered like the Western esoteric tradition and how it became an influence and why you felt, you know, you had to include it in your work? Because this stuff is both omnipresent, but it's also that esoteric. Occult means hidden, right? So it is below the surface. So how did you first encounter it, get interested in it, see the connections between it and art?
Well, yeah, I'm going to answer in a non-linear way, because I think in the past 2 years, I've been studying Vedic astrology, and I can see that the eighth house, and which is connected with Scorpio, is the house of the occult. And certain humans that have this house that is developed in their chart and exalted will have natural tendencies to question what is beyond the physical. So I have had these tendencies. Now I know, like, the rational, not even the rational, but I understand myself better to know that this was a natural interest and curiosity of mine. Being Gemini, I'm naturally curious, but I always knew there was something behind the veil, and I didn't understand it. Like, even as a teenager, my friend was like, no, there's nothing there. And I was like, no, there has to be. I have no idea why, I just know. And so this kind of thought that I had, I remember telling my friend when we were maybe 17, has never kind of exited my mind. So I was always curious to delve into quantum physics at first, to understand those mysteries from a scientific point of view. Found that its limits, and then was like, okay, there must be other sources I can look. And of course, these old ancient, like, this wisdom is in books dating thousands of years old, and you can find all the answers there. So for me, then it was more like developing my intuition so that I can decipher what resonates with me, because at first it's just overwhelming. And then just finding the approach that fits with me. You know, we all have our own ways of learning, and this occult knowledge is very vast. So like finding my own flavor that works with my system to understand and integrate those systems, those philosophies.
Absolutely. So obviously we want people to view and buy your individual paintings, but when you create an installation, you have a lot of thought behind it. Like, what are you trying to do with installations? And of course, if people want to buy an entire set from an installation, I'm sure you wouldn't say no. But if you can tell us about the sort of complete vision that you do when you have a showing.
Yeah, installation was also a natural way for me to have people enter a certain mental, like, I see an installation, not as like a collection of different like artworks, but more as like the walls of the space become a mind and you enter a mind. So like you're entering this realm, this spiritual realm, this frequency where every artwork becomes like a different color of that frequency so that you can overall get a more, I guess, holistic view of what I'm trying to convey here. So instead of just having one thing, a 2D image from a painting, well, you also have, from my last show, you have a light. So like I had like this kind of UV blue light that is like one of the thinnest that we can see with our eyes, bringing this kind of, yeah, this kind of spiritual energy or a mystical, yeah. And then all the pieces kind of become a, I use a lot of symmetry as well to convey some principles, because symmetry is naturally recognized by our subconscious mind. It's very easy to absorb. So often like one wall will be complementing the other wall and we'll be communicating this way. So creating a dialogue between each. In the last one, I had used an ancient ritual, which I reproduced physically because it's a mental ritual. And creating, yeah, the ritual, these ancient rituals that I'm practicing, they are very old and they use symmetry as well and the cardinal points to convey universal codes to your psyche and therefore be able to reprogram it. So I guess in this sense, my last show was also to introduce people to these advanced psychological tools that for me are the future. They are the past and they are the future. I have a feeling that they will reemerge as a science soon. And I think they are so powerful, and I think they need to be demystified and detabooed. That's a word.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting because whenever you read any of those mystics, occultists, spiritual magicians, the whole groups of them from the 1800s and the early 20th century, that they're always saying what they're doing is a science, right? And then when you go back further than that, you know, somebody like Newton, the great scientist, was also an alchemist. We find that many of these great scientists throughout history were doing what now we would call weird esoteric stuff. So I think that's a very interesting perspective, and I think an interesting hope for the future that I'm sure many of us share. Now, for those who know nothing about spirituality and esoteric or might even be opposed to it, right? You know, many artists are, I mean, many people, we live in a very materialistic time, a very secular time. They think that not that this stuff is weird, but that it's silly, right? That it's a waste of time, that there's no truth to it, even if you're working on a symbolic level. Is your art for people, you know, who hold views like this, who are not interested in spirituality or esoterica?
Well, that's a good question, and it's hard to say because I guess like I understand that like you resonate a certain frequency and so does your art, and therefore attract people that resonate on that frequency or that need that frequency to be activated within them. So in this sense, I think it's a bit simplist, but I would say my art attracts the people it needs to. So I think the common person will at least feel something from it, because it's very packed in symbols and our psyche reacts to symbols. Therefore, whatever the people see, they will receive either something deep or something that will just evoke mystery. And I think mystery is the symbol of the question mark. Any question marks is creating a void within to be filled. So if it just creates a little void to be filled with the answers that they had never thought they needed, well, there you go. And for the people that reject it, well, that's okay. Like, I don't think there's anything wrong to not resonating with these things. We all have like our unique journeys and path. But this being said, from like a collector's point of view, like in the contemporary art world that does like collect for museums and stuff like that, I think this type of art is new and has kind of evolved from my perspective, from the there was a big show in New York a few years ago, Hilma af Klint, and that kind of set the tone for. And I had a podcast last week, and this insight came as we were discussing. But it feels like she was the creator that opened this portal for now art. Art that has always been, like, I guess, the seed of the consciousness of humanity. If you look at art, it always shows how humans, it kind of brings, like, if humanity is there, the artists create something that shows imagery or symbols that are bringing humanity forward. And I think she had this big seed to help artists now be allowed to create contemporary art that talks about these topics again. Because it was back then, it had been tabooed in the past, I don't know, few hundred years. And I think because of that show, now it's accepted again, and it's starting to be even, like, not encouraged, but valued. And so in this sense, I think there is a renewal, and it's promising for the spiritual artists in the contemporary art field in the future, which is also what I'm trying to set myself as being, like, I want to empower other artists to not fear the taboo and not fear the rejection, and to feel like they have a place, which is,
I think that's an amazing linkage of insights, you know. And it's ironically, at the time that show was at the Guggenheim, I was going between New York and Montreal a lot, but mm-hmm. I wasn't able to make it to the Hilma af Klint show. My wife did. And I also missed the French symbolist occult show that the Guggenheim did. But I think that both those shows do prove that there is something happening, both in the culture and in the art world. And I think you're right that Hilma af Klint, she's very interesting, because even in her own time, she didn't show very many of her paintings. So it's almost like they're coming back exactly when they're needed. And this flows really well, you know, the last two things that we discussed into my next question, which you kind of already tackled, but maybe we can pull on a few threads here. But, you know, what is the role of esoteric spirituality in this secular and materialistic world? And in the question sheet I gave you, I said secular and materialistic world, but, you know, it's kind of more than that right now. I think we live in a particularly dark time that seems to be getting darker almost every day. So what do you see a public role for the knowledge that you're engaging with this esoteric and occult stuff?
Yeah, like I am, like, positioning myself right now as a visionary artist, because I think it's a word that needs to be kind of reinforced in the sense, like, I think artists now have to have visions of the future, because that's how we create a future that is. We have to imagine it first, and artists being the people that kind of channel this information, it's our role to create this imagery, this symbolic imagery of the future. And as we enter this new era, this new age of Aquarius, I really think, and that's the movement I have on my heart to create, is to empower the artists that are doing this type of work to focus and fine tune even more their crafts to be specifically to create something that's for the highest good of humanity, that will liberate them and not kind of make their head go down and, like, become more of a slave, an unconscious slave to the powers. Yeah. And so I think we have the biggest role, like, ever, because it's been these eras change every 2000 years or so, and now we're right in the transition. So more than ever, it's important to talk about those things and to push artists to not fear their own inner world and to actually go there to access, but always with intention, which is intention for the greater good. Because often we will take decisions that are egoistical without knowing it, if we don't have that intention. And so I think that we artists and creators, because I want to include creators, and because artists can be put, like, in a box.
Yeah.
But creators, whether you're just anyone at all that creates intentionally his or her life, I think it is important to talk about it and empower these people Create with intention. Yeah.
Yeah. And you have a very active project now to empower people on this path. And it's Roze Umbra, right? Could you tell us what that is? Tell us about your coaching, your vision, how you got started, please.
Yeah, well, Roze Umbra, like it came out of me. It feels like it was an organic, it just popped out of me in this sense. Like my life is always within, I try to live it the most possible with intention, but also without planning too much, so that I can actually go exactly where the river wants to go without having to create dams to like block, or you know what I mean? Yep. So last year I moved to Spain. I was going to start this project, art retreat, a spiritual retreat. Like it felt like it was a soul project of mine. Ends out, I didn't get the visa after like a year of applying for it. It was so complicated and everything. And then they just rejected it with no reason. So when I arrived a month after, I was like, okay, I have to find another solution. I'm going to create a business so that I can apply for this other visa. And so there came about Roze Umbra. But ends out, probably the whole direction, my whole soul was bringing me to Spain, so that I could let go of my past, let go of everything I owned, and focus on Roze Umbra. And Roze Umbra became, now that it's been a year, I can see that it's a reflection more of my soul. Like my art, Roze Umbra and my art are becoming kind of interconnected, but through Roze Umbra, it's more of a soul humanitary like vision, and working directly with people instead of working through art to reach people. It's more direct. So now there's different facets to it, but like I say, I like to let it flow so that I don't say this is Roze Umbra. Roze Umbra, I want the rose is the flower, the rose, and it's the heart that opens up. And in this case, Roze Umbra is my heart that's opening up, and the channels within me that are opening up to be able to be of service with Roze Umbra, to the rose, to the heart. And so, for now, the petals that I can see opening up, there is a retreat. I do a soul care. So I create many like different free resources on YouTube. May it be breathwork routine that have been very helpful for me in my development. I have a mystical relaxation technique from Israel Rigardi that I read his book, and I created these tools so that people, it's easy to access. You just press play and you can get guided into this very deep mystical relaxation and access this place of yourself where you can manifest instantly, and different various like resources like this. And the other facet that is now that I've been passionate about is helping people one-on-one. So through Vedic astrology that I've learned, Ayurveda as well, I have a little background in this, and tarot. So I've done all the three to give people an idea of their own purpose, like where they're soul will feel the most fulfilled and will be able to be of service to humanity. Because often, like I say, if you're not an artist and you're not doing this active work of healing through your art or any other mediums, well, perhaps there's a lot of layers to go through before you can feel like you have something to offer to the world and you can see where it is. So I want to show people the bigger picture of their lives through the tools I've learned over the years and help them kind of integrate these parts of themselves so that eventually they can be fulfilled by being of service.
And it's not, just to clarify, even though you said this, it's not just artistic coaching, right? It really is for anybody if they're feeling stuck, if they want to go deeper, but it is also for artists who perhaps want to pull more out, are blocked, want to move forward, are looking for something. Is that right, Alex?
Yeah, at first I was I wanted to work specifically with artists and creators because this is the industry and the, like, I've been in this realm for so long that for me it is a natural thing to do. But ends out, like, I wanted to open it up with, like, it's not just artists, it's artists and creators, anyone that feels unfulfilled and that wants to create their life. Maybe they don't have a strong will, maybe they don't have a, they're scared of taking risk because of a trauma that they have not processed. Whatever it is, just to give the tools that I have to help you become your own creator, your own magician in some ways. And then the visionary artist part, I am working also like on a more on the long term, let's say middle long term, with people with many sessions to like help them go back, study their artwork, help them understand and process why they took those decisions in their artwork, as for their art to become also the vessel for change in the world. And this being said, I also started my own podcast where I interview people that are very grounded in their work, that are visionaries, and that I want to showcase these people and create a movement with these people by putting them under an umbrella where it's a thing. It's not just isolated individuals that do that. It's a movement that is world, that there is more and more people that are feeling this call to heal the world through their creations. So I want to put these people on the spotlight and encourage people to watch them too, because they are doing the work and I believe in them, and I think they deserve more attention. But also, like, people need to understand, because often they do it unconsciously or they do it not necessarily with this intention, but their work is doing this. So I want to kind of have discussions and like go deep into the work and show people that it's important to connect with your inner world as you're creating.
And for everybody listening and watching at home, please go to the show notes. We're going to have links to everything that Alex is doing, right? So you can check out the retreats, Roze Umbra, his homepage, the podcast, his YouTube channel. It's all going to be there. It's kind of a tactical question that's more for me, but I hope people find it interesting. You know, sometimes I struggle because, you know, I'm part of a modern Gnostic church, and we also are an esoteric and mystical church. We pull on a lot of interconnected but different streams of tradition, right? Mm-hmm. So I really like Hermeticism, but I also really kind of like the more hard-edged Gnostic stuff, right, that you would find in the Akamadi. And sometimes these teachings, these bodies of wisdom, these interconnected but different movements can be contradictory. And, you know, you've mentioned a few different things like Vedic astrology, tarot. Like, how do you, when you're drawing from these, how do you deal with the contradictions? Tell me about that.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think it's pertinent to also the age of Aquarius that we're entering, because if you look at Aquarius from an astrological point of view, it is an individualistic sign. So it's about knowing who you are, but it's also about, it's also like a world sign, a humanitarian sign. So it's knowing who you are, but for the sake of humanity. So it's both at the same time. And I think this reflects in our personal religion and our personal beliefs. And I think the future lies within this. I think the institutions that are more dogmatic and that have like their presets, their Bibles, their everything that tells like the rule of conduct, I think that's moving. We're moving from that. It's going to become you have your own church. It's your body. You have your own religion, your own beliefs, and they are unique to you. So in this sense, I think that's what I'm doing with the tarot. Over the years, I've picked up on tools that resonated with me. I've made them my own. The tarot, I probably don't use tarot like anyone else. I probably don't use Vedic astrology like anyone else. And Ayurveda too. And I created my own tools within those. So I spend like a month like creating my own tools to share with people that I work with to integrate these things together. So I use the Crowley deck of tarot, and it has all the astrological correspondences. And then when I use it, I always use Vedic astrology, and I put them together to give an even sharper message for the person linked to exactly where these influences affect them. So I created my own system that works for my own intuition, for my own inner world to be basically a mirror. Like, I have a lot of Cancer energy in my chart, and it's basically that to become a container, and then people can project themselves within it, and I create the tools to project them, for them to project in, and then I just give it back to them what they gave me, but with a new flavor and a new perspective. Hope that answered the question.
It does. It does. It's an awesome answer. Well, we're just about at wrap-up time, but Alex, we're recording this at near the end of February 2024. You never know when people are going to watch or listen to this, right? Mm-hmm. But we're going to not bank this show. We're going to make sure to get it out soon because you have a retreat coming up. Can you tell us all about this retreat?
Yeah, so retreats have been part of my dharma. It's very, for me, it's like creating an installation, but like where people are living inside the installation. So there is a, I love to, I'm very symbolic and intentional with my artwork, same with the retreats. Like I like to plan everything that builds off each other. Every workshop, every meditation will be specific to build a momentum. And so this retreat is all about finding your purpose. So everyone that signs up gets free astrology reading at first. So we get to see your dharma, your life purpose, get a bit of insight. And then when we go there, the first day is a silent retreat. So day one, all in silent. And all the workshops are meant to access your subconscious mind. So there's techniques of art therapy I've developed to help people create symbols. And then we analyze them to understand what your subconscious is trying to tell you. There's meditations that are designed for this. And then all in silence. And the next day is the active day. So it's the equinox retreat. So it's like the night and the day, the unconscious and the conscious. And then so the next day, it's more like, okay, now we found some clues. People are invited to journal their journey. So all the symbols that they will accumulate over the first day, the Vedic astrology reading, will create a narrative for us to interpret. The next day, we're putting it in practice. There's a workshop to vocalize to people what you think it is, so that you put it in words, you put it in the concrete. We're creating a talisman to embody our intentions with what we've discovered and activate it with a ritual. So there's a lot of mystical aspects to it too. And the goal is that people come out of these 2 days having a more clear image and more empowered to follow their truth.
That sounds awesome. I wish I could attend. But as people at home know, I have a baby. I'm going to be using that as an excuse for the next 18 years. But you know what? If you sign up for Talk Gnosis, you can, for our Patreon, you can help us keep the show going for as little as a dollar per piece of media per month. It's patreon.com/Gnostic. One-time donations at paypal.me/Gnostic. I'm bringing up the baby because technically we send you the shows early, and lately I've been banking a lot, but due to the baby, I've been forgetting to do that. I'm sorry. We love you patrons, but we don't really give our patrons anything because we don't know what to give them, and we don't want to lock up any content behind a paywall, right? Because we want all this stuff out here. So you give from the good of your own heart, and you will occasionally get some shows early. I swear we're going to get better at that. I'll send you baby pics. She's adorable. Sign up for the Patreon, and you will get some adorable baby pics. Because every parent says this, but she really is cute. Alex, I've been throwing up one of your homepages on the screen for those watching, which is alexcoma.world, which is very easy to remember. So everybody go there. But for the specific links to the retreat and the other projects and the podcast, it's all going to be in the show notes. Make sure you go to the show notes. If you're able to go to the retreat, you should, because it sounds really powerful. So Alex, I think we got to wrap up, but it's been awesome having you back. I look forward to having you again in the future and to all the wonderful things that you're bringing out.
Yeah, it was nice to catch up with you too. And for people that want to go directly on the website, it's www.roseumbra.com. So,
also super easy to remember. Yeah, thank you.
So, yeah, it was nice to catch up, and thanks for having me again. I'm looking forward to the next one.
Yeah, thanks, Alex. Bye.
Bye.